John Shimano with the Child Welfare League of America. And of course, when I hear these discussions, I always think of Capitol Hill. So I think the question is, how do you get their attention to prioritize this, to put the money on the table, not just when there's a drug epidemic in their district, but when there is an ongoing issue and primary prevention is always left behind?
There may be other answers here, but I'll tell you ours from the perspective of our foundation. Honestly, the last place I want to go is Capitol Hill to look for money. Everyone is out there. Everyone's got a constituency. The reason this has been a failure to thrive all these years is that the constituency hasn't had, we think, a national organization that has brought the private sector to bear on Capitol Hill. When I was a resident, all children under 3 pounds died. All children with acute lymphocytic leukemia died. And everybody wondered what would ever happen with that. 50 years later, because there were people who, at the Cancer Society, at the Heart Association, at March of Dimes, at everywhere else, funded early research and advocacy, formed chapters. 50 years later, there's been a huge amount of research, and this field has been left behind. So I really am not interested in going to Capitol Hill first. I'm interested in getting all of the people in this country who've experienced this problem. We know there are a lot of previously abused children who have broken the cycle as adults, never abused their parents, but who now need to break the silence, get over the shame, as Lori said, and start contributing to help build from below the pressure that will inevitably add the work to everyone else. We don't want to displace anyone's budget. Everyone has worked too hard to do what they're doing and get what they're getting. We just need to add it. I mean, I'm impressed or depressed, depending, when I look around, and we visited the American Suicide Prevention Foundation, and we've talked to the obesity and eating disorders people. If you look at their grant programs over the years, there are none. There's none on the relationship between abuse and the downstream impacts and all of the ACEs that all of the health issues that Christina was talking about. That's what we've got to go there with money and say, can we match it? Can we work together? Can we take off the blinders? Can we help with CASEY, the child welfare organizations, look at more at outcomes and the quality of practice and get the patient's perspectives, the client's perspectives on what's going on to improve practice and improve how things go?
Yeah, so I totally agree with that. We have to circle the wagons at every end, and if we have interest in policy but nobody backing it up in the public, it's really not going to go anywhere. However, there is a group called the Campaign for Trauma-Informed Policy and Practice that I'm a part of and that many other people who've worked really hard for the last many decades are coming together on to look at the micro ways that we can change existing policy and practice and start to put into place expectations that existing programs and policies really become trauma-informed and aware, build into credentialing and the way that we train requirements related to this area in terms of translating the science, and in shaping the kinds of policies for child welfare, schools, and healthcare so that they can start to share either resources, data, and the really concrete issues. So there's a lot to be done in policy, and a concrete example is PTSD, which is for adults, is one of the only definitions we can put in our coding to get paid for treating people with trauma, but it's very different for developmental trauma disorder. It's completely different. It requires a lot of different approaches. So advocating for those kinds of things as legislation occurs, like through the opioid crisis and what's happening with home visiting, and as we deal with health reform, there's a huge number of opportunities, and we need all hands on deck while we build the real infrastructure for that to actually get translated in a big way, the way Dick talked about.
So I realize that we're just on the first question.
No, we're good. We're good. Yeah, and there are not a lot of questions. Okay. This is just a conversation, and we've got 6 minutes left.
So I would have to say that there is already bipartisan interest in this issue. John, you know that the Family First Prevention and Services Act was passed by Congress this year, and part of what it will allow is for some of the federal dollars to go to prevention and early intervention. It is not necessarily as robust as one would like and doesn't necessarily carry all of the provisions that one would hope to see, but it is one of those bipartisan things that did pass Congress. On the other hand, the point about the private sector and others becoming more involved, engaged, and active is absolutely the critical piece. Because funders, whether it's health or whether it's child welfare or whether it's nonprofits in general, have funded on cycles of grant making that are not life cycles for human beings. That too needs to change, and I believe that's a part of what we are all beginning to see as the private sector comes together to take a look at what are reasonable ways to approach life cycle issues, not on a grant cycle mentality.
Amen.